So I've been singing since I was 3, 4, Carnatic music. And then I stopped singing Carnatic music when I got saved because, you know, most of it was very religious. And so then it was Western music and just, I always wanted to make my voice heard. Because, I mean, you sing, you love to sing, and I was hoping I was good. I didn't know. I didn't really know if my voice was good or not also, like the texture wise and all of that. But I really wanted to explore that. Even in college, I remember wanting to join these, you know, music associations and all of that. But I would always feel God saying no to performance, to these kind of... My dream was to tour with a band in college days, you know, be in a band, go around. Yeah.
Like an electric guitar or something? Or
Maybe. I would have loved to play lead guitar. I loved it. Anyway, so that was like a huge dream. I mean, like, it was there, all of these things.
Yeah.
Then I also wanted to, I don't think I ever dreamt of being a worship leader as such. It was more about singer-songwriter, express myself through music, reach out to, you know, artist kind of thing.
Yeah.
but I think God just intentionally kept me away from all of that. And also music was something I couldn't explore. I just thought it was too late for me to learn the keys. And I was like, I was supposed to be a child prodigy, but now it's too late. My life is over. By the time I was 15, I had like quarter life crisis all of that. So I always had those dreams, but I would always feel God saying no to it. Or just like not making it happen, like closed doors everywhere. Even in church, when I eventually joined the choir, I think when I joined the choir is when I got filled with the Holy Spirit also. So that time was actually, I don't know why we keep coming back to that moment today, but that was really a turning point for me in terms of worship, because when I joined the choir, they made sure, like, you know, they were like, who is not, you know, filled with the Holy Spirit? It's a Pentecostal church, guys, sorry. But when they did that, it was such a turning point for me. And when I finally joined the choir, for the first time in my life, I felt like, whoa, this is what I'm alive for. This is what I'm supposed to be doing. First time in my life, I was like, wow, I found some purpose and some meaning, because till then I was just questioning and being like, what do I do in life? I told you, like, I wanted to do 100 different things. Like, should I do this? Should I do that? But for the first time, I felt really alive, like in a way, like nothing else had made me feel alive. And so that season was really special. I would just worship. I didn't care about... So that's the first time, like, I started just worshiping, however, not bothering about what people are saying. And so even, like, on stage, I would just, like, smile and worship, and people would come to me later and be like, I love the way you worship. I'd be like, why are you watching me? Close your eyes and watch.
Should be watching God.
Yeah, because I already didn't want to be on stage. But anyway, so that season, I just loved just worshiping God. But even then, my voice was not heard. Like, most of the times, like, either my mic would be really low, or like, or it would be off. I don't know. But it's just like God still hid my voice. And I remember so many times going home and just crying to my mom because someone will be mean to me in choir, or just find some way to put me down for no reason. And people used to do that, like, all the time. And that's similar to Joseph's story, right? Like, they would just do that, like, in school, in college, all through. I mean, even in the non-music part, right? Like, there have been times like that. But especially in, like, choir and worship, I'm like, yes, this is what I want to do for God. And in that situation, there would be so many times that either people wouldn't hear me, or, you know, no one would really hear. But I remember in that time just learning that it doesn't matter whether people hear you or not. It doesn't matter whether... And my mom played a really big role in that also, encouraging me, praying for me, and being like, it's okay, you know, you just worship. God is doing things. God is, you know, ministering to people. You don't need to be heard and things like that. So that was a time when I learned to let go of it and be like, it's not about my voice. It's not about what I bring to the table. It's just about exalting God and seeing His presence move. So that was a season I really got tuned into, okay, God is moving right now, you know, just worshiping Him in the Spirit. And And then when I came to face to face, and you know, that was one of the lowest points of my life, because before I came here, because I had been, I just kept everything.
Thank God it was before.
It was before. I kept everything aside, like everything church and God aside that time. Because I reached a point where these things that I was believing God for, like basically we were believing God for the restoration of our family and things like that. Because we thought honor would come like that to us. Because we'd gone through so much shame, and so we thought God would honor us that way by restoring us and like making us a family again. Because we kept believing for that. But when that didn't happen, I had another breakdown in my spiritual journey. And I was like, I still worshipped God, but it was from a place of, yes, God, you deserve my worship. You can have my worship. But my heart was like, I shut off parts of my heart. And those were like the hardest years of my life, more than what I went through initially, because I tasted intimacy with God. I tasted this place in His presence. And then I had just got shut out of that. So like 2013, 2014, 2015, I was just pursuing my career, my education, my master's. I was like, I need to work. I need to make my own life, you know, be the architect of my destiny. Because God, I mean, it's good to do that. But I just shut God out of it, because I was like, you're not really concerned about my happiness. You just want me to lay down everything, surrender, sacrifice. So, but in doing that, I also really shut myself out from the presence of God. And I, and after a while, I couldn't get back to it as much as I tried. I wanted that place of intimacy. I longed for that, but somehow I just couldn't. And, I came to, you know, like when you run after the things you want, eventually you come back to square one, and I landed there, and like, I was at like rock bottom, because my health was gone. My emotions were all over the place. I was so stressed out in life, and I was just at my lowest point. And I was like, God, this is not what I want. I want you. I really want you. I can't go ahead without you. And I knew that my career as, like, you know, business psychologist or, you know, HR, I was into HR. So I knew that was not, I knew there was something more. And I was like, I'm dying on the inside. If I don't have what God wants me to have, it's just all like just withering away on the inside. And it started to show on the outside as well, like inside out. It did. It really, like all my areas, all the areas of my life started suffering, because on the inside I was not prospering, I was not thriving. But during that time, God also like pruned me, and I went through some of the hardest things. It was like God really like cleaned out my life during that time. So many things happened. It was like such a cleansing process. And looking back now, I know all of those hard, crazy moments, like God started to deal with my rejection issues. He started to show me like how to deal with insecurity. Like I knew I had insecurities, but that was the time God was doing something that I couldn't do for myself by just putting me through that process. And though it was painful, I think it was some of the best years of my life because of what God did. And after that, He brought me to the house, to face-to-face. And I know I talk about face-to-face a lot, and the people here and a lot. The thing is, like, that season was, I told you, I was at my lowest point, and I couldn't find my way back into God's presence. But the first time I stepped into this place, I was like, I was taken into that place in the throne room suddenly. I found myself there, and I was like, I know this place. I've been here before. And I freaked out. I was like, I'm never coming back to this place again. I left, and then, in January I came. And then after that, I only came back for the internship. God brought me back. Yes.
Praise God.
But I was just so like shaken up by His presence here. And that's when God restored that place of intimacy. And that's why it's so special to me. So after this season where like it was just about getting to know God, worshiping the audience of one, and just learning how to minister to Him, so many things happened inside of me also. Like God showed me what worship is all about. You know, is it about the songs? Is it about what I can make the room feel, or, you know, what's happening in the room? Or is it about obeying Him? Like even when leading here, right? Like moment by moment, we would depend on Him. Like so many times I'll just, we would have a song list, but then like the Holy Spirit would be leading in such a very close manner that you'll know in that moment, okay, this song or something else, right? And just that whole experience has been one of the most precious things, because worship in the end is that. It's just like looking at his face and responding to that. Gazing at him and obeying him in response to whatever he's saying, right? And so that's one of the most important things I learned about worship as well. And so, that's how God prepared me for that whole season. Before Chattan happened, I kind of knew God was bringing me out of hiding. Because I knew God had intentionally been hiding, because it was obvious by then. So I was like, okay, I know God had a purpose, he had a process. And I could feel the weight of that whole call and that whole destiny also. And I felt like my time here, those 3 years that I was here, God really prepared me with so much of encouragement, so much of guidance, so much of correction, character pruning through Mr. Nixon, Lino Gobes.
Fun
much
part.
Much needed. No, but like these are the things that really shaped me and prepared me for to even handle something like this. So when it actually happened, it wasn't about my voice being out there or people saying, because it could have, like, one thing I was really worried about was, oh my gosh, this is going to get to my head. This is going to ruin my relationship with God. I'm going to fall like Lucifer. But I think by that time, God had prepared me so much that I wasn't consumed by that fear, at least. Because even being here at the house, people telling me how blessed they were through the worship. And I knew, like, it could only be God, because there were so many moments when I was so out of it. I would have the worst days and I would just come and worship, but people would be so blessed and God would just take over. And I think that's what happened even with the Bridge Music Camp. I think 2 weeks before the camp happened, I went through something so scary for myself. Like, I was like, am I even a Christian? You know?
No.
Yeah, I was in that place. I was like, what is happening with my emotions? What is happening with my life? I don't deserve to be in this camp. I don't deserve to be with all of these amazing songwriters, you know. And I remember having this amazing one night. I was in Chennai at RZIM, actually. And I remember having this time. I was like, God, I don't have anything to give. And I don't know what I'm going to do at this camp also. And I was just listening to this song called Prabho Maza. It's the first time I heard that song. Rachel has sung it, like, from Bridge. So I was listening to their songs, trying to prepare for the camp. But I encountered this song and I don't know, that whole night I just didn't sleep. I was just like, God, it's you or nothing else. Like, there's nothing else that I can do. And I just kind of just gave myself over to him completely. And it was just that availability. I said, I have nothing to give, but I'm going to go there because you made this happen. You called me to this. And so I'm just going to go there and you do whatever you need to do.
Wow.
And that's actually the backdrop for Chattan.
Yeah. So probably people don't know. You didn't even write it.
I didn't write it.
But you end up singing it.
Yeah. So we just wrote it at the camp and then Sam says, come and sing it. And I was like, we were all really encountered by that song. Actually, like, a couple of other songs were even better and we were like, these are the songs. No one knew that this song will, you know, no one knew. But something about that melody, the chorus, that melody really, like, spoke to us so much. And I was so honored to be able to sing that song.